Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of The White House Pantry Murder by Elliott Roosevelt, narrated by Nelson Runger. This book is copyrighted 1986 by Elliott Roosevelt. This performance is copyrighted 1987 by Recorded Books, Incorporated. It's Christmas 1941, but the ever-present Nazi threat makes this holiday season one of the bleakest in our nation's history. In the White House, President Roosevelt and First Lady Eleanor prepare not so much for Christmas, but for the arrival of England's Prime Minister, Winston Churchill, and his entourage, including Lord Beaverbrook, Lord Halifax, and Sir Alan Burton of Scotland Yard. In anticipation of Churchill's visit, security measures have been dramatically increased, with anti-aircraft guns mounted on the White House roof and soldiers on alert 24 hours a day. The December air fairly crackles with tension. Despite all these efforts, an intruder somehow gains access to a most unlikely place, the walk-in refrigerator located in the pantry. And now, the White House Pantry Murder.
Chapter 1. Later, 10 and 15 years later, Mrs. Roosevelt would find it difficult to reconstruct those weeks, much less to believe events had occurred that she could never recount except to that very small group in whom she trusted without reservation. In 12 years in the White House, she was privy to many secrets. From history, she believed, one should keep very few secrets. But some things she would never tell, even to people who thought they knew all she had to tell. Other secrets she would confide, charily, to a select few. The White House. The public has never understood this, but the White House is appreciated by its tenants, if it's appreciated at all, for the honor of living there, not for its luxury. The handsome rooms on the first floor, the ones the public sees on tours, are public rooms, showcase rooms for state occasions, otherwise a museum. Well and good. But the public, if it could see the private apartments on the second floor, might be dismayed to discover that the first family lives in a suite of awkwardly constructed rooms, furnished chiefly with what they have brought from home. Only half a dozen rooms are really private, and the family sitting room is actually a part of the west hallway. None of this counted much with Mrs. Roosevelt, or with the president for that matter. They were content with the White House. After all, as the president might have said, no one condemned them to live there. All he ever complained of was the food, and that wasn't a function of the mansion itself, but of the housekeeper Mrs. Roosevelt employed to command the kitchen. The White House wasn't an unpleasant place to live, and the Roosevelts had made a home of it. They'd had time enough. Until December of 1941, that was when everything changed. As Mrs. Roosevelt contemplated Christmas 1941, she was depressed, as she had never before been in her White House years. The war news was alarmingly bad. Hundreds of thousands, in time it would be millions, of young men were being processed hurriedly into the armed forces, and there could be no question but that many of them would die in their country's service. Her own sons were going to war. And simply as a matter of statistics, she had to anticipate that at least one might be killed or injured. How could all the good things this presidency had achieved, and for which she had hoped it would be remembered, possibly survive the ordeal the nation now faced? She would always remember that December as a time of darkness. Real darkness, that is, not just darkness of mood. The days were the shortest of the year, the nights longest. The weather was cold and gray. What was gloomier, the White House had been enveloped in grim wartime security. The windows were fitted with blackout curtains. Anti-aircraft guns were mounted on the roof and on the grounds. Soldiers patrolled the fence. It was only because the president had specifically forbidden it that army tanks didn't guard the gates. Gas masks in khaki canvas bags hung from their straps on the furniture everywhere in the house. They were urged to carry them about, though no one did. Her independence of movement was circumscribed. She had been accustomed to shaking off her Secret Service escort and traveling as she wished. No more. Now the agents insisted she must have their protection, and in this the president concurred. The First Lady couldn't look forward to Christmas, knowing that none of her children could come home. For Franklin, it would be a difficult time for yet another reason. His mother had died in September, and this would be his first Christmas without her. He still wore a black crepe armband on his left arm, the sign of his formal mourning. Distressing as holidays with her formidable mother-in-law had sometimes been, she had been able, nevertheless, to look forward to having the family together at Hyde Park, with a fire burning in the great fireplace, stockings hung, a tree. This year, even Christmas wouldn't bring relief from gloom and tension. She hid her feelings and showed a face of resolute self-confidence. She was no less energetic. Indeed, she reached out for new responsibilities, as if she possessed reserves of energy that had never yet been tapped. As the president shouldered the heavy new burdens of wartime leadership, she searched for ways to do her share, and she found them. In private, though, for a time, her optimism failed her. More than once during those weeks, she shut herself for a little while in her room, and there, in small moments of privacy, Mrs. Roosevelt wept. Monday evening, December 22nd. "Tonight?" exclaimed Mrs. Roosevelt. "But they were not due until tomorrow." The president nodded. He had sucked in his cheeks and the corners of his mouth turned down slightly. He shrugged and pulled smoke through his holder, into his mouth and deep into his body. Then he nodded again and let a faint smile replace the expression of mild annoyance with which he had made his announcement. "They've been at sea 10 days, you remember." He shrugged again. "They decided to leave the battleship at Hampton Roads and are flying into Washington."
"Then they will be here for dinner."
"Something very informal," he said.
"For how many?"
"Oh, I should think 15, maybe 20.
"I don't see how Mrs. Nesbit can be ready."
The president's smile broadened. "Tell her she'll have to be ready," he said. "Tell her she'll just have to set her schedule ahead a few hours."
"But Churchill..."
"He requires brandy, cigars, I trust he'll have brought those with him, a hearty meal, none of Henrietta's tuna sandwiches, and tell her to send people upstairs to be sure his rooms are ready."
Mrs. Roosevelt sighed. "Yes, of course."
The president glanced at his watch. "I'll be leaving for the airport soon. Will you join me, Babs?"
"With dinner for 15 to prepare on an hour's notice? Really?"
"That's what you pay Henrietta for. Give her her marching orders and come along to greet the Prime Minister."
She shook her head. "I shall greet him here. I have a feeling that this is not the first time he will completely abandon his schedule and impose a new one on us at a moment's notice."
The President laughed. "According to Elliott, who visited him at Checkers, you recall, Winston is more royal than the King. Let Henrietta remember that. I won't have the Grand Alliance broken up over some household idiosyncrasy."
She recognized him, of course, as soon as he stepped through the door. He was unmistakable. Short, rotund, cherubic, some said, florid, the sandy red hair almost gone from the top of his solid head, jaunty little bow tie a bit askew, heavy watch chain draped over his ample belly, fat cigar clamped between two fingers of his left hand. Not an especially prepossessing figure at an instant's glance, yet a man whose calm, confident power required but a moment to make itself evident even to a casual observer.
"I believe I have the honor of addressing Mrs. Roosevelt," he said before anyone could introduce them.
"Mr. Churchill," she said, "welcome to America. Welcome to the White House."
"Thank you. And please allow me to present my colleague Lord Beaverbrook, our Minister of Supply."
She smiled and greeted Beaverbrook, the Canadian millionaire who had transplanted himself to London, there to occupy the center of British journalism and political life. For all the years he had spent in England, Beaverbrook somehow retained the look of a North American. Something indefinable in his style, in his bland, uncommunicative face, that set him apart from the archetypal Englishman who had introduced him.
"Admiral Pound," said Churchill, "and Field Marshal Dill."
He didn't see fit to introduce the others who stood behind him, and she took them for staff. His personal valet, probably, a secretary or two, perhaps a security officer or two.
"The Prime Minister," said the President, "has told me he will not require more than a few minutes in his rooms before he is ready for a pre-dinner drink. Shall we say cocktails in the green room in 15 minutes, dinner in an hour?"
That arrangement, said the Prime Minister, would be most agreeable.
Mrs. Roosevelt found Winston Churchill an engaging and yet infuriating man. He had, as Elliott had warned, a regal air about him. Though the Prime Minister was cordial and friendly and faithfully attentive to the small niceties of courtesy, he kept between himself and everyone around him a measured distance that was not to be crossed. He was witty, he was entertaining, yet his conversation was heavy. He tended to pontificate, and when he did, he expected his pronouncements to be heard and pondered. She was surprised to discover that this most famous of parliamentary orators had a speech impediment. He spoke with a slight lisp. She suspected he had worked to correct it only up to a point, and beyond that point had kept it as an element of his unique style.
"We must not," she overheard him tell the President and Harry Hopkins, "forget Jean Bart and Richelieu."
He was talking about two French battleships that remained in North African ports. It was important they not fall into the hands of the Germans. It was serious talk, but she couldn't help but smile at the way he tried to impart a French accent to his pronunciation of the names of the two ships. The French language, she concluded, wasn't powerful enough to overcome the Churchillian accent. He partook thirstily of the brandy the President offered him, so much that Mrs. Roosevelt guessed he was tired and tense and would want to retire immediately after dinner. Although there had been talk of assembling a first conference, she guessed it had been postponed. When she heard the President and the Prime Minister agreeing on an agenda for the evening, she was surprised. As they took their drinks and chatted, Secretary of State Cordell Hull arrived, followed by Sumner Wells and General George Marshall. Lord Halifax, the British ambassador, appeared soon after. A few minutes before they were to go in to dinner, Mrs. Roosevelt noticed a tall young man in the uniform of the British Navy standing uneasily to one side of the room, without a drink, conspicuously ill at ease. It wasn't in her nature to allow anyone to remain so. She had suffered too many awkward hours herself, many years ago, when the company of crowds of people she didn't know was painfully uncomfortable to her. She stepped over to the young man and spoke to him.
"Oh," he said, "Mrs. Roosevelt, it's an honor to meet you, ma'am." "And you are?"
"Excuse me, I'm Lieutenant Commander George Leach, of His Majesty's ship Duke of York."
He was tall, more than 3 inches above 6 feet, she judged. His face was lean and bony, the pale skin of his cheeks oddly shiny, as if newly and delicately scraped with a sharp razor. His disciplined, dark brown hair lay smoothly combed. He looked down at her with an expression of grave unease, which she decided might not be of the circumstances in which he found himself, but a constant of his personality.
"Allow me to introduce you to the President," she said.
He followed her across the room to where the President sat in his wood and steel wheelchair, his cigarette holder atilt in the famous Rooseveltian gesture, his second martini in his hand.
"Let me present Lieutenant Commander Leach," said Mrs. Roosevelt,
interrupting a dialogue between the President and the Prime Minister.
"I'm pleased to meet you, Lieutenant Commander," said the President. "Has no one offered you anything to drink?"
"Well, I..."
"Arthur,"
the President called for Arthur Prettyman.
"Isn't there a bit more of this glorious nectar in the shaker?"
he asked, raising his martini glass.
"Pour some for Lieutenant Commander Leach. Let's introduce him to an American vice."
"George is serving in Duke of York," said Churchill. "His father is member for Wapping Oldfield, and a friend of mine since George was undreamt of. When I found George aboard ship, I invited him to come along as a personal aide, give him an introduction to America, and something to remember during all the hard days he's going to have to endure."
"The Duke of York is a new battleship, I believe?"
said the President to the young officer.
"Indeed, sir," said Lieutenant Commander Leach. "She was only recently commissioned. Bringing the Prime Minister here is something of a shakedown cruise for her."
"You've been comfortably accommodated, I hope," said the President.
"Yes, sir."
"George will be setting up my situation room," said Churchill, "in what I believe you call the Monroe Room. I look forward to receiving you there in the morning, Mr. President. We will have all the latest information on progress on every front, shown on maps, Libya, Malaya, Russia, all of it. Constantly kept up to date. I urge you to establish such a room here in the White House. It's invaluable for keeping yourself current."
"I will be interested," said the President. "Perhaps Lieutenant Commander Leach can show one of my people how you have it arranged."
"I will be more than pleased to, Mr. President," said the young officer. Mrs. Roosevelt, herself never taking more than a single glass of sherry before dinner, was a close observer of people and their drinking habits. She found it difficult to approve her husband's long-time habit of drinking 2 martini cocktails every evening, although she had never seen any ill effect on his personality or on his ability to cope with whatever the next hour might bring. The president's personal assistant, Harry Hopkins, on the other hand, didn't handle it so well. He sometimes came down to dinner in a state approaching inebriation. He lived in the White House in the Lincoln Rooms in the east wing of the second floor, so he might be available to the president at a moment's notice and at any hour. And when he didn't join the president for his evening cocktails, he ordered up ice from Mrs. Nesbitt and held his own cocktail hour, sometimes bringing in friends from outside. She observed that these Britishers tossed off whiskies and brandies as if they were lemonade. Winston Churchill, she knew, had something of a reputation for his intemperate consumption of spirits, whiskey and brandy. There were even jokes about it. Lady: Mr. Churchill, you are drunk. Churchill:
I am, madam. But consider, in the morning I shall be sober, and you will still be ugly.
It was amusing to watch him clutch both his cigar and his glass of brandy in one hand. With practiced facility, he put first one and then the other to his mouth, never ceasing to talk and gesticulate as if he were unconscious of smoking and drinking. The brandy had no visible effect on him. He drank what Mrs. Roosevelt considered a rather large amount of it, but his voice remained biting and his carriage firm.
My grandfather, she overheard him say, was American, you know. Leonard Jerome, my mother's father. A fascinating man, captain of industry. Did you know that Minnie Hawk, the world-famous operatic soprano, was my mother's illegitimate half-sister? He nodded. The resemblance between her and my mother was remarkable. And she wasn't his only illegitimate child. He founded the Jockey Club in New York, you know, made and lost several fortunes. He once sailed a small boat across the Atlantic on a bet. A far more interesting man than the 7th Duke of Marlborough. This referred to his paternal grandfather. I should like to think I manifest some of the qualities of Leonard Jerome.
Which ones? Asked the president in mock innocence.
Churchill chuckled appreciatively.
Take your choice, he said.
Mrs. Roosevelt's next surprise occurred at the dinner table. She shouldn't have been surprised, as she realized when she thought about it. All the English visitors, including Lieutenant Commander Leach, ate with hungry enthusiasm, expressing their appreciation of the fresh vegetables and fruits on the White House table. It hadn't occurred to Mrs. Roosevelt that even the Prime Minister didn't have access in London to fresh food and plenty of it. She made a mental note to tell Mrs. Nesbitt to serve as many fresh vegetables and fruits as she could. The company didn't linger over the meal. Although Churchill allowed his wine glass to be refilled twice as the hour passed, instead of growing drowsy, he seemed to become more animated and more anxious to open the conference. He asked her, in fact, if she would mind if the conferees were served their coffee in the Oval Office rather than at the dinner table, to which, of course, she readily consented. It was with an undiminished sense of surprise that she watched the President and the Prime Minister, with their chief assistants and advisers, troop off toward the Oval Office to open an immensely important conference in the middle of the evening. For herself, she went up to the third floor to look in on Missy. Missy LeHand, who had served the President faithfully through so many years, was ill now and kept largely to her room, her speech impaired, her left hand partially paralyzed. She continued her valiant effort to bear her share of the president's burdens, but she was too weak to be what she had been. She spent lonely hours in her little suite on the third floor, and Mrs. Roosevelt made a point of going up to visit as often as she could. Coming down to the second floor after a quarter of an hour with Missy, she encountered Lieutenant Commander Leach crossing the stair hall from the Prime Minister's suite to the Monroe Room. He carried a red wooden box.
"Ah, Mrs. Roosevelt," he said. "Our Situation Room is almost ready. Would you care to see it?"
She accompanied him into the Monroe Room, where huge maps now hung from the walls or stood on easels, each one brightly lighted with flood lamps. Another naval officer was at work sticking flagged pins into a map of the North Atlantic.
showing apparently the location of British ships and perhaps the location of U-boat sightings. Another officer at a desk listened intently to the telephone, frowned, and made notes.
"Situation in Malaya is deteriorating, I'm afraid," said Lieutenant Commander Leach. "Defense of Singapore is going to be a rum go."
"What news from Russia?" she asked.
He pointed at the map.
"Reasonably stable for the moment," he said. "This," he touched a pin, "is the deepest penetration by Army Group Center, which is the one that most worried the Prime Minister. Field Marshal Bock seems to be stalled."
The only place name that immediately impressed itself on Mrs. Roosevelt was Moscow, and it seemed to be half surrounded if she read the flagged pins correctly.
"I suppose you mean the Russians claim they've stalled him," she said.
Lieutenant Commander Leach smiled. "The Prime Minister pays no attention to Russian communiques," he said. "Our information is from Jerry. We monitor his radio traffic."
"But isn't it coded?" she asked.
He smiled again. "I'm sure it is. But our chaps have their ways."
She stepped closer to the map and studied the pins, showing the location of German army divisions.
"George! Oh, I beg your pardon."
"Quite all right, Sir Alan. Come in. Allow me to introduce you to Mrs. Roosevelt. Ma'am, let me introduce Sir Alan Burton, of Scotland Yard."
"Sir Alan Burton?" she exclaimed.
"Quite so, madam," said the tall, sepulchral English civilian. "And I don't look a thing like Archibald Adkins, do I?"
Mrs. Roosevelt laughed.
"No, Sir Alan, you do not."
He was the Scotland Yard inspector who had been impersonated by the criminal Archibald Adkins during the investigation of the poisoning of Philip Garber more than 2 years ago. Adkins had succeeded in convincing the British Embassy, as well as Mrs. Roosevelt, J. Edgar Hoover, and everyone else concerned, that he was Sir Alan Burton, the man who now stood smiling at her.
"Do I owe you an apology, Sir Alan?" she asked.
"Oh, not at all, dear lady, not at all. Archie was a smooth one. He might have convinced me he was I."
"Not if you looked in the mirror, Sir Alan," she said.
Sir Alan Burton was a thin man with a long, hollow-cheeked face and very mobile, thin and gleaming red lips, which seemed to extend halfway to his earlobes. He was perhaps 50 years old. His complexion was gray, his eyes watery blue. His graying yellow hair was stuck in place with dressing.
"To what do we owe the honor?" asked Mrs. Roosevelt.
"My current assignment is to attempt to prevent Winston from getting himself assassinated," said Sir Alan. "I've spent the evening with your Secret Service chaps. Decent fellows. I think we shall have no problem. Who, after all, would want to harm so marvelous an old boy as Winston?"
Chapter 2. She didn't know how late the conference continued. Her bedroom and sitting room were at the southwest corner of the house, and she didn't hear the president returning to his bedroom to retire. Tuesday morning, out of her room at her usual early hour, she was surprised to see how busy the Britishers were. Looking in on their situation room, she found the Prime Minister already there, fully dressed, already smoking, already on the telephone, stabbing a short finger at one of the maps and saying something emphatic to someone at the other end of the line. He looked up and saluted her silently, obviously continuing to listen to some response over the wire. Mrs. Roosevelt smiled and returned to the elevator in the West Hall. She descended to the ground floor. Her first meeting of the day had to be with her chief housekeeper, Mrs. Nesbit. Ordinarily, Mrs. Nesbit came to the second floor to meet with Mrs. Roosevelt and discuss the day's meal requirements and other housekeeping problems. Today, Mrs. Roosevelt wanted to start earlier, since she knew Mrs. Nesbit would spend much of the day shopping in Washington food markets to find, at reasonable prices, the kind of food she hoped to serve the Englishman. Mrs. Henrietta Nesbit was a neighbor from a town near Hyde Park, New York. She was a stolid, unimaginative German woman who had never allowed herself to be shaken by the president's or anyone else's complaints and jokes about her kitchen. She knew nothing of haute cuisine, cared less, and set herself to serve solid, nourishing food out of the restricted budget imposed on her. Mrs. Roosevelt liked and respected her. What was more, the woman was bearing up well. Last night's dinner had won praise from the Prime Minister, and even the President had complimented it. Even so, it was doubtful that either Mrs. Roosevelt or Mrs. Nesbit had anticipated the kind of visit this was turning out to be,
and meeting the expectations of the regal Mr. Churchill was going to prove trying. The main kitchen of the White House was a spacious wood-paneled room equipped with the heavy old cast-iron ranges and sinks of the last century. Mrs. Nesbit complained little, but she had complained of the battered utensils with which her staff was expected to prepare the White House food. The household budget had been strained to buy a few new pots and pans. Congress did not appropriate funds to re-equip the kitchen. It was a make-do kind of place, in which the staff struggled to prepare everything from sandwich lunches to state dinners. Mrs. Nesbit was primly, some would have said grimly, dressed in gray, with her graying hair tied back tightly, her rimless spectacles set firmly astride her nose. "Ach, I was on my way up," she said, glancing at the kitchen clock to see if she had somehow lost track of the time and omitted to keep her morning appointment with Mrs. Roosevelt. "We have lots to talk about, and I thought we might get an early start," said Mrs. Roosevelt. "Have you had any problems?"
"Not really. Only that Mr. Churchill sent his valet down last evening to pick up a half dozen cakes of bath soap. Half a dozen! He said Mr. Churchill would want them all around him as he soaks in his bath."
"Indeed, half a dozen. And what else?"
"About a gallon of coffee at 5:30 this morning. I am told he soaks in his bath before dawn, surrounded by soap, drinking coffee, and smoking cigars."
"Temporarily," said Mrs. Roosevelt, "we seem to have become an outpost of the British Empire. If he asks for a Negro to fan him with an ostrich plume, tell him we can't accommodate him."
Mrs. Nesbit was not often seen to smile. Doubtless she did, but doubtless also she considered it an unseemly expression to be displayed in public. Now, however, she allowed herself the luxury of a small, pinched-lip smile, one that might actually have turned into a grin if she had allowed it.
"They have not had fresh vegetables, fresh fruit," said Mrs. Roosevelt. "Buy as much as you can. Serve as much as you can. They can't get fresh produce in wartime London."
"Will the Congress appropriate something for the extra expense?" asked Mrs. Nesbit.
"Yes," said Mrs. Roosevelt. "For Mr. Churchill's table they might even appropriate money for brandy and cigars. Anyway, we'll take the chance. Spend what you have to."
"Ach," said Mrs. Nesbit, "I'm told he's brought his own brandy, several gallons of it, and enough cigars to fill the house with smoke."
"But fresh things," said Mrs. Roosevelt, "fresh meat, fresh bread."
"I quite understand.
Oh, my dear!"
A maid had stumbled into the middle of the kitchen, ashen, mouth agape, eyes wide and vacant. She gurgled, unable to find words.
"Joyce!" exclaimed Mrs. Nesbit. "What in the name of heaven?"
The young woman choked on her words and pointed to the door of the walk-in refrigerator. Mrs. Roosevelt and Mrs. Nesbit rushed to the refrigerator door. Mrs. Nesbit shrieked and staggered back. Mrs. Roosevelt stood and stared. Lying face up on the floor of the refrigerator was the body of a man. His blue eyes were open as if he were staring, but an instant's attention to them showed they were as lifeless as the eyes of a fish on ice. His lips were parted, his pallid face fixed in his final paroxysm of surprise. He seemed about to speak, yet it was plain he would never speak again. Mrs. Roosevelt stepped back from the door.
"Call," she whispered.
Mrs. Nesbit had the telephone in one trembling hand already. Nodding, she spoke to the White House operator and asked for the duty officer, Secret Service. Mrs. Roosevelt steeled herself and stepped into the refrigerator. She forced herself to kneel and touch the forehead of the dead man. It was cold, unnaturally cold, since he lay on the floor of a room kept at something like 38 degrees Fahrenheit. It was difficult to believe his eyes wouldn't turn and follow her hand as she reached out tentatively and touched his clammy flesh. But of course they did not move. In the grotesque paralysis of death, they remained in a stare fixed forever. Shuddering, she rose and left the refrigerator.
"Mr. Baines will be here in a moment," said Mrs. Nesbit.
And he was. Gerald Baines, Special Agent, Secret Service, Department of the Treasury, chief agent on duty that early morning of December 23, 1941, had only a short distance to trot to respond to Mrs. Nesbit's anguished call. He entered the kitchen within the minute, followed immediately by a second agent. Joyce Carter, the uniformed maid who had discovered the body,
sat on a straight wooden chair, her face covered by her hands, weeping quietly. She was a young black woman who had worked in the White House for 6 years, and who had impressed Mrs. Roosevelt with her quiet and faithful attendance to duty.
"Joyce," said Bain softly, "you slip across the hall to the doctor's office. We don't need you here."
"Don't need no doctor," Joyce wept.
"But you can be comfortable over there," he said. "Just lie down and be comfortable. If we need to ask you anything, I'll come over."
Joyce nodded and slipped out of the room.
"I think I need not inconvenience you, Mrs. Roosevelt," said Baines. "I'm sure Mrs. Nesbit has any information I need. If I need any from you, I can call."
"With your consent, Mr. Baines, I will stay," said Mrs. Roosevelt in a crisp, forceful voice. "In all the circumstances, the presence of Mr. Churchill and his people in the house and all the rest of it, we may find some special considerations prevail. I'm especially concerned that no unfortunate publicity attend this matter. We cannot imagine for this moment what consequences might follow a public announcement that a mysterious corpse has been found in a White House refrigerator. I speak of diplomatic consequences, etc."
"Of course, ma'am," said Baines deferentially. "I didn't mean to dismiss you, only to suggest you might rather leave."
"I think I should rather stay, Mr. Baines," she sighed. "Unfortunately, this gentleman is not the first human corpse I've seen."
Baines nodded. He was a florid, 50-year-old man, his bald head flecked with liver spots, his modestly rotund belly shoving out the vest of his gray wool suit. In ordinary circumstances, Jerry Baines was a bright, cheery man, ready with a quip, a smile fixed on his shiny face. Right now, he was sober-faced, but Mrs. Roosevelt judged that even confronted with an unidentified corpse in a White House refrigerator, Jerry Baines would rather smile. The second agent squatted beside the body in the refrigerator. Mrs. Roosevelt didn't know his name and quietly asked Baines who he was.
"Dom DeConcini," said Baines quietly. "A good man."
DeConcini was an exceptionally handsome young man, features sharp and fine, complexion swarthy, eyes dark and penetrating, a non-committal, non-communicating smile fixed on his face. He was going through the dead man's pockets.
"Odd, this," he said, looking up at Baines.
"What?"
"His pockets are empty. There's nothing to identify him. No wallet, no keys, no money, not even a nickel, not even a trolley token."
"What killed him?" asked Baines. "That's what I want to know."
DeConcini shook his head.
"Not a mark that I can find so far. No blood. I don't see a bruise. There might be one."
"Check the label in his suit," said Baines. DeConcini pulled the man's suit jacket open. It was true there was no blood to be seen, not a stain on the white shirt. The agent squinted at the label inside the suit.
"Sears Roebuck," he said. "Could have been bought anywhere for $17.95.
"That makes him an American anyway," said Baines.
"Not necessarily," said Mrs. Roosevelt.
"No, of course not," Baines agreed. "I meant to say he's probably American, probably not one of our British guests."
"It's really odd," said DeConcini, continuing to search through the clothes on the corpse. "No money, no keys. Somebody went through his pockets and took everything off him before they dumped him in the refrigerator." "What evidence is there that he was dumped in there?" asked Mrs. Roosevelt. "Maybe he died right where we see him."
"What would have been the last hour when anyone entered this refrigerator?" Baines asked Mrs. Nesbit. She shrugged. "I can't imagine anyone having any proper purpose in it after, say, midnight," she said. "You can see what's stored in it, meat, vegetables. Someone may have called for ice after midnight, but ice would have come out of one of the smaller refrigerators."
"Oysters?
Oysters? After midnight?" Mrs. Roosevelt asked.
Mrs. Nesbit lifted her chin.
"Mr. Hopkins calls for oysters at all hours," she said. "He eats oysters and drinks whiskey at any hour."
"Indeed," said Mrs. Roosevelt thoughtfully. "Well, anyway, we don't know who this man is or when he died. We don't know why. So we have on our hands a very difficult problem, have we not, Mr. Baines?"
"We certainly do, ma'am," said Baines dolefully. "Of course, the autopsy,"
Mrs. Roosevelt cleared her throat, and Baines took it for a signal to be silent and let her speak, though in fact such was not her intention at all.
"The circumstances," she said, "create an unusually delicate situation. Will you permit me to offer some suggestions?"
"Why, certainly."
"First, I'm afraid that we have no choice but to allow the agents in charge of the Prime Minister's security to participate in the investigation. It would be most awkward, would it not, Mr. Baines, Mr. DeConcini, if we kept the matter from them, only to discover, say, a week from now, that the dead man is one of their party, or that they know who he is. We are fortunate in that Sir Alan Burton of Scotland Yard has come to America with Mr. Churchill. I'm told he is a most experienced, shrewd, and circumspect investigator. I suggest we take him into our confidence. Baines nodded.
Very well. I'll ask him to come down before we move the body.
Mrs. Roosevelt nodded at Baines. I think that is a wise course, she said. Now, second, I think we will all understand the absolute necessity of keeping this matter entirely confidential. It simply must not become a matter of public record until the English party has returned to London. We have enough reporters beating on our doors as is, what with the Prime Minister and his party here, without attracting the police reporters from every newspaper in the nation.
I entirely agree, said Baines. He glanced at the body lying on the floor of the refrigerator. God knows what the significance. Joyce can be trusted, said Mrs. Nesbit. Other than Joyce Carter, no one knows about this but this group here, the four of us.
Of course, said DeConcini as he rose from kneeling by the corpse, we mustn't forget the one that killed him. That makes five at the least.
For once, said Mrs. Roosevelt, there may be something positive in wartime security. Let's see to it that no one who is not possessed of the highest security clearance is given the information.
What about the president? Asked Mrs. Nesbit. Surely you'll have to tell him.
I'd rather not, said Mrs. Roosevelt. But yes, I suppose I will have to tell the president. And I suppose Sir Alan Burton will insist on telling the Prime Minister. But please, please allow me to take responsibility for that.
Will you act as coordinator between us and the British? Asked Gerald Baines.
Mrs. Roosevelt nodded.
Let's not call it anything also official as coordinator, she said. Let's say that I will speak with the President and with Sir Alan Burton. If necessary, I will speak with Mr. Churchill.
Baines frowned at the staring corpse. I hope we find he is just a young man who went in to steal a bit of steak and slipped and banged his head. I'm afraid, though, it won't be so simple. Sir Alan Burton, the real Sir Alan Burton, not the impostor who had visited the White House in 1939, came to the kitchen a few minutes after he was called. He was occupying a room on the third floor, as were Lieutenant Commander Leach and others of the British party. You see, said Baines, we haven't moved him. Sir Alan lifted his chin and looked down over his cheekbones at the corpse that still lay on its back on the refrigerator floor. Ah, he said. Quite dead, I imagine. If not dead from other causes, then likely frozen. What possibility he was thrown in here unconscious but alive, and then did indeed freeze to death overnight? Well, the autopsy will answer that question, said Baines. Short of that, I think the fact that his eyes are open is pretty clear evidence that he was dead when he was deposited here.
Not necessarily, dear chap, said Sir Alan. I'm reminded of the case of the late Marchioness.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.